Let us be in an attitude of prayer. God, it's so good to be here this morning, to come up the front walk of a place that we love so well. God, we appreciate so much the gift of your Spirit in this community that has allowed us to feel at home here, whether we are new or whether we've been here for decades. God, thank you for this community, this church, for our brothers and sisters in Christ, and thank you so much for the faith and the health and the life that has enabled us to be here this morning. God, we ask that you would allow us through the presence of your Spirit to be open to your movement today, that we would receive what you have for us. God, we ask that if we're in need of a word of encouragement, we need to be built up or supported, God, by you, that we would receive that. We ask that if we need a challenge, if we need instruction, God, that we would be open to that as well, and that we would receive it from you. God, as we come here this morning, we want to come fully ourselves, the good parts and the bad parts. So help us to examine ourselves as we come to worship today, God. And if there are faults and deficiencies, if there are sins, God, we ask that we could be honest with ourselves as we are honest before you, and that we can invite your healing touch into our lives, that you would mend us and make us whole and holy, so that we can better express your love to this community and this world. Thank you, God, for hearing our confession. God, we ask today that you would be moving in situations for which we are concerned. We pray for Sarah LaMonica, who is in the hospital right now with pneumonia, and ask for healing. And thank you that Ray is able to be here today. We pray for Albert Staples' friend Lee, who has cancer. And we remember those, Lord, who are in recovery from addiction. And we ask that you give them strength in this minute, in this hour, and in this day. God, we ask that you would minister to those who have depression. Lord, be with Michael Boucher's parents and allow them fullness of life this week. And also for Susan Morris's father as well, Lord, we remember him today. We ask that you would enable Richie Snyder's leg to heal after an injury on vacation. And that you would be with the Helen Stanley's friend Cheryl, who lost a child, an adult child, to addiction this past week. Comfort her, Lord. We ask God for a prayer of provision over the elections in Russia today. We also pray for Vladimir Putin, Lord, and ask that, knowing that you work in the hearts and minds of our world leaders, that you work there especially. We pray for Dan Cody, a tow truck driver who was killed on the roadside this past week, and ask for comfort for his family. We thank you for his service and his life. God, there's many joys among us this morning. We celebrate the ministry of Alcoholics Anonymous today, remembering the great work that it has done for many of us and many whom we love, Lord. Thank you for that program. We thank you for news from Marsha Lawson, a founder of our church, who's doing so well at 96 years old. Lord, we ask that you be with her on a road trip in an RV with her daughter and allow her safety and a good time. We ask for safety for Joan Tarbox and also Gail and Rachel Montez, who are in Florida. We ask and celebrate a successful surgery for Bonnie's friend Maureen. And we ask God for a safe return to the United States from Ecuador for Noah Spicer. God, you do so many good things for us. Fill us with a heart of gratitude today as we worship you. We ask that you would hear us now as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. As we prepare to hear the special music this morning, I have to note that this special piece of music was requested from me because today our district superintendent, Renee Perez, was to have been with us during worship, and this is a favorite song of his. He called me on Wednesday and said that an emergency had arisen in one of the other churches on the district and that the bishop asked that he would be at that church instead, so he will reschedule with us, which means you guys get a first take before the real performance.
This is a practice run.
But we will do this on Facebook Live for the DS so that he can see that that we wanted to give him this gift today. It's in one of our songbooks, and this is the way that it's written. It's Christ beside me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, King of my heart, Christ within me, Christ below me, Christ above me, never depart. So let's see if we can do it. Christ beside me, point beside me. Christ beside me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, King of my heart. Christ within me, Christ below me, Christ above me, never to part. Isn't that neat? Daniel, do you have amazing, or morning is broken?
Are those the words for it?
Those are the words. It goes to morning is broken.
I know a different morning is broken.
That's right. Let's do it one more time.
So you get
it that one. Let's do it one more time. Christ beside me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, King of my heart, Christ within me, Christ below me, Christ above me, never depart. And so what St. Patrick was helping us know is that Christ is all around us. He's outside of us. He's in us. And that through the Holy Spirit, God can be in our lives and be all around us, like we're in a Christ bubble. Have you ever heard that you live in a bubble?
No.
Yeah, it's like a Christ bubble. So that is a gift that St. Patrick gave to us. Today for Sunday school, you all have games.
Yay!
We've got some Wyatt boys in the back. Thank you, Aiden, for leading games. We appreciate you.
Yay.
So let's have a prayer and then we'll go. Lord God, thank you for giving us St. Patrick, that he was a great teacher so people could know more about you. Thank you that you are beside us, before us, behind us, above us, below us, and especially in our heart. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We have a few verses of it. Let us read it together. Psalm 119. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. I seek you with all of my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. And now please hear the scripture lesson from the Gospel of Mark.
This is from the book of Mark, chapter 14, verses 3 through 9. While he was in Bethany, reclining at the table in the home of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume, made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. Some of those present were saying indignantly to one another, "Why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages and the money given to the poor." And they rebuked her harshly. "Leave her alone," said Jesus. "Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want, but you will not always have me." She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. Thanks for reading.
Lord God, once again, we thank you for the time that we have here this morning, time free of other busyness, other worries, and other concerns. God, we ask that you would allow us, both in our hearts and in our minds, to clear a space for you so that we can receive this gift from you, that we can reflect on your word, that we can be open to your spirit, and that you might apply these words into our life. We ask, God, that you would help me to think and to speak clearly. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So for you keen observers of the Aldersgate Cast of Characters sermon series, you will note and remember that this is the third time this scripture lesson has come up this year, the third time we have heard this story. The sermon series that we've been doing since the fall is following a book by Max Lucado called Cast of Characters, in which he dedicates a chapter, each chapter a different person in the Bible. And so we're looking at regular, ordinary people that God used to do extraordinary things. And I would be very honest with you that when I mapped out my sermon series, I said, this is a wonderful book, and I love Max Lucado, he's a great writer. And so I saw chapter one, chapter two, and so I scheduled it out on my calendar. And here it says Mary, and I said, oh, good, Mary. And here it says Mary, I said, oh, that must be the other Mary. And then it says Mary again, I said, it must be another Mary. And so I scheduled it out, and here we are for the third time on the same story of the Bible. Maybe it's an important story. Maybe that's what's going on. Third time hearing about a woman who came to Jesus and broke a jar of very expensive perfume and used it to anoint him in some way, probably right before Jesus was going to be arrested and tried. This story is one of the few that appears in all four of the Gospels. A woman came, broke a jar of perfume, and anointed Jesus' body. What's interesting is the story shifts a little bit as we go through the different versions of it. The location of it changes. The response of the people changes. The location where she anointed Jesus changes from his feet to his head. But one thing that never changes about it is that the jar of perfume that she broke was extremely expensive. Some of them say almost translate to almost as much as a year's wages for like a common laborer. We were talking about this last night at dinner church, and I said, can you imagine if someone came in with a jar of perfume, if there were such things, Sam tells me there is such thing, a jar of perfume that costs $140,000, which is the cost of the kitchen, and also what some of us make in a year, right? $140,000 bottle of perfume, and broke it and poured it out over Rob Lynch's head, right here. You like that? And the rest of us would be furious, because we could say, we could have paid for the kitchen for that, man, that could have gone to ministry. It was an extremely expensive jar of perfume. As I was reflecting on this, I thought to myself, you know, in the course of Christianity, in 2,000 years, and going around the entire globe, I imagine the cost of that gift is what stands out, because in most of human history, we have not been living this prosperous of a life. In most of Christian history, people have had to live very frugally, could never dream of it being a reality to do such an extravagant thing. People didn't splurge. There's not money to splurge on things in most times and most places. But what I noticed is that we live in a really prosperous time. And you may be saying, Rachel, you didn't see my water bill and especially my heating bill from last month, and I'm not feeling very prosperous at this particular moment. But if you can take a step back, take a big step back, you realize that we have so much. We have so much that something like a splurge has become, you know, not an everyday thing, but it's something that people do. When was the last time you took a little me time? Who took some me time? Somebody. What'd you do?
A facial.
A facial. That was yesterday. I thought it was Facebook. Yeah. That's right. A little me time. A little splurge, right? That's nice. Who else splurged? Someone else. Kathy, what'd you do?
I got a massage.
Massage. We like this. This has a lot to do with anointing. Maybe anointing is the theme, right? What'd you do, Sam, when you splurged?
We had ice cream for lunch.
Yeah, right? We like that. It's a part of what we do. And like you'll go and you'll see a woman with a beautiful new bag or a guy will pull up in a new truck or something like that and say, oh, it's really nice. And the person will say, yeah, you know, I just decided to go for it, right? I work really hard and life is stressful and I just wanted to do something for myself. And we say, of course, well, you deserve it, right? You do work hard and I'm glad you were able to do that. Have a little splurge. Do that. Spend the extra money. So we splurge on ourselves, but we also love to splurge on other people. Like, is there anything better than seeing the joy on someone's face at an unexpectedly large gift? And so we will do this, especially parents or as spouses. All we need to know about our culture and our willingness to splurge on things, we can find out by watching car commercials at Christmas, right? I mean, you would think it was relatively common. It's got to be somewhere out there that someone has given their spouse a car with a big bow on it at Christmas. Is it going out to spend $40,000 without telling your spouse? It's like, no big deal. That's just a gift you do, right? And I'm just curious, one more time. Does anyone know anybody who's gotten a car for Christmas or birthday? You do?
It's one of the vendor reps, and he's going to get his wife a car for Christmas.
Unbelievable to me. So it's out there. It's out there. It happens. So we have this thing where we like to splurge, and we live in a culture that allows us that because we have enough abundance to do that. So what of this pouring out a bottle of really expensive perfume? I mean, it was kind of a big gesture. It was really extravagant. But why so extraordinary that Jesus himself said that this woman would be remembered anywhere that the gospel is preached? Why so extraordinary? I want to suggest to you that when we do splurges, like my friend, my girlfriend, she said there was a group of us ladies, most recent splurge, she had secured, booked a really nice vacation for her family, for her husband and her two children. And she did it well in advance, and then they had some money trouble, and it was unexpected. And she was talking to us about the adjustments they were making in the budget. And she said, well, we have this vacation planned for February. And if we were responsible, if we really thought it through and were wise with our money, I would cancel that expensive vacation. But then she said, it's my kids. And I've been working so much, and I'm gone all the time. I don't want to take that away from them, right? They deserve this splurge, this gift. I want to suggest to you that when we do things like that, when we give an extravagant gift to someone else, or if we give it to ourselves, but especially to someone else, it's almost never anonymous, is it? It's almost never anonymous, and it almost always is a way of patting ourselves on the back or making us feel good, right? Especially if it's the gift we give ourselves. We know that's a pat on the back, and we know that we worked hard for it and we deserve it. But if it's for somebody else, what would that mean if we couldn't see their reaction? If they didn't know that that gift came from us, we want them to know that we love them, right? And so we tell them, I'm giving you this, and they give us this big thank you, and they cry, and they say, that's wonderful, and we feel good, and we get that pat on the back. Those splurges are things that ultimately serve to make us feel good about ourselves. Fine. Good. Think about Mary. In Mark's version of the story, the woman anointing Jesus' head is Mary of Bethany. This is Mary who has a sister named Martha. You remember Mary and Martha? Martha's running around in the kitchen, and Mary's sitting at Jesus' feet listening. This is Mary and Martha and their brother Lazarus. Lazarus, the one who was raised from the dead by Jesus after an illness. When Mary gives her gift to Jesus, she is not splurging on herself. And she is, in a sense, splurging on her friend. But I suggest to you that Mary, in this case, the reason we're remembering her, the reason it is such an extraordinary gift, is because Mary is splurging on God. And so I ask you, when was the last time you splurged on God? I want to tell you something. When I was writing this, I had to start wiggling in my seat. You know it's working. The sermon process is working when the preacher starts feeling uncomfortable herself. When did you last splurge on God? When did you give with such abandon you didn't sit down and calculate the cost and how much time and how much energy and how much money? You didn't even think about it. You just gave. When did you? So now we're all feeling guilty, right? Okay, because I did. I was like, what a thought. This is not about guilt, my friends. Let's think about why Mary did her generous action. Mary's life had been absolutely transformed by Jesus. Jesus had saved the life of her brother. She and her sister and her brother lived together. We gathered that they were unmarried, and therefore that the brother is the financial support of that family. And when she and her sister Martha were losing their brother to illness, and then when he died, they are losing their livelihood. Not only that, they're losing an emotional piece of their life, their brother, their friend. And so when Jesus brings him back to life, he literally saves Mary's life as well, because he's provided for her income and he's given her back a member of her family. She's incredibly grateful, and not only that, she has been able to sit at the feet of Jesus and hear about God's love for her. He has transformed her view of the world. He's transformed the view of her own self-worth and who she is and how she is loved. He has given her a whole new perspective on her life here on earth, and because of the resurrection of her brother, has given her a new perspective on death and God's victory over death. Mary's life has been completely enriched and transformed because of Jesus' love for her. And so when she makes this extravagant gesture, it is absolutely joyful. She's not the one sitting there thinking how much the perfume costs. Everybody else in the room is thinking about this. She's thinking, this is the very best thing I have, and I want to give this all. I wish I could give more. He has done so much for me. And so I give this joyfully as an expression of my gratitude to what Jesus has done for me. That's where it comes from. This is not coming from a sense of guilt or obligation, or maybe if I do this, then Jesus will do that for me. This is coming in response, in gratitude, in joy. And that needs to be the location from which our gifts from God, our extravagant gifts, our splurge, that needs to be where it comes from with us. We have a generous church, generous in time and in money and in talent. And we all, and me and hopefully and many of you, sat down and said, yes, I want to support this church, and I'm going to sign up to do this, and I'm going to give my time at the breakfast, or I'm going to help shovel the walk or paint a wall or whatever it is. I'm going to fill out my pledge card so that we can make a budget. And we do this, and it's usually in a very careful way, isn't it? How much time can I afford? How much money can I afford? And that's thoughtful, and that's good stewardship. But what if we tap into, again, that sense of gratitude towards God? That sense of gratitude for all the things that God has given us. So that when we're presented with a need, we can say, yes, God. When we received another gift from God, another blessing from God, we can say, yes, please receive this from me as a thank you. Can you spend some time on someone that the world doesn't spend time on because they're irrelevant or lame or whatever it is, some other reason, but you say, I'm going to spend this time because God spent some time on me. Can you be extravagant in your forgiveness of somebody who's harmed you because you know that God has been extravagant in God's forgiveness of you? Can you be extravagant in providing something that the ministry of the church needs or something that is needed for God out in the world? Can you do that because you see that God has provided for you? Or are you grumpy? I was grumpy this week. I'm going to be honest with you. I was a little bit grumpy. And I was this is why the sermon called me on the carpet, because I've been feeling grumpy. I feel like I've been praying the same prayer at God for like 6 months, and I haven't seen any movement. I'm like, God, you know? And so I'm like, come on, man. Like, I've been faithful with my prayers. I want to see it. I'm feeling grumpy. Feeling like God hasn't stepped forward. What if I choose, or if you've been feeling that way, what if you choose instead to say, well, that prayer has not yet been answered. However, I remember the things that God has done for me. I remember the forgiveness that I received. I remember the mercy that I got in a moment when I should have been judged. I remember when I was provided for, when I thought it wasn't going to work at all, it was never going to happen. I remember the love shown to me. Right? Can we go through the things in our lives that God has done in our lives and recite those things rather than what God hasn't done yet? Right? And from that list of the things that God has done, we can dig deep and put our roots deeply in there so the gratitude starts to come up and well up in us. So that when we have an opportunity, when we are moved by the Holy Spirit, we can say, yes, God, this is what I want to give you back. Without regard to whether it's strategic or practical or makes sense or anything, this comes from my joy because of what you have done in my life. I pray that we can be people like Mary. Not people just who give extravagant gifts, but people who are tapped into that joy, into that gratitude, and so that the work of God can be accomplished by God's love flowing out from within us. Amen. So, this week we have an opportunity to hear a second report from one of our youth about the 30-Hour Family, which is a poverty awareness program that the Wilmington United Methodist Church puts on. Alex was not able to be here last week, and he said, oh, please, please, please let me share in person live. I said, okay, all right, Alex, that would be great. But it also gives us an opportunity to remember if we would like to give a gift to the work of World Vision. So if you would like to do that, please make sure it's well labeled and write the check or cash to the church, and we will get it donated. Alex, tell us about your time.
Okay, so this month I had the honor of attending the 30-Hour Famine. Now, I know for most of us, going without eating for 30 hours seems impossible. But if you are truly determined, then you will succeed with God's help. When I arrived at the Wilmington United Methodist Church, I was treated to a friendly welcome. After I placed my things in a quaint room upstairs, I headed to the fellowship hall and was surprised to see so many people there to participate. After we were assigned groups, we headed off to our work sites. I went to Cor Uno, which was a restaurant-style food kitchen, which served the homeless people as many as they could feed. We prepared fruit kebabs, pigs in a blanket, and so much more. I learned later that day that we had made food for over 200 people. Just to paint a picture for you, there are roughly 553,000 homeless Americans in this country alone. Worldwide, 1 in 9 people are without food. When we got back to the church, we made cookies for a bake sale, which gave 100% of the profits to World Vision, a humanitarian aid organization. The rest of the day was spent playing games and learning about what homeless people have to endure. The next morning, each group had to create a part of the worship service and had to relate it to what they had done that day at their work site. My group had the task of leading the children's moment. We taught them that at Cor Uno, it didn't matter if you came first for food or last. Everyone who walked through the door got fed. Throughout the duration of those 30 hours, I saw God at work when I was making food, creating the children's sermon, and when I heard what other groups accomplished at their work sites. I felt a sense of pride in how people from different churches could come together and do God's work with seamless efficiency. I also learned that all of us can make a big difference in the lives of homeless people across the nation.
Alex, we have a photo of Cole of the scroll down. And Alex, why don't you tell us what you're doing? Cole, 2 slides. There we go.
Oh, so that was the children's moment. We related it to the Olympics about how it didn't matter if you came first or last, you still finished. Mm-hmm. And we related that to Cor Uno. Whether you came first for food or last, you still got fed. And the arrow is pointing to me. I'm wearing a blanket because as people donated unused fabric items, such as that lab coat that my friend next to me is wearing, they made blankets for homeless people.
Thank you. Also, during these 6 weeks of Lent, we're having folks from the church share on their spiritual practices, what works for them on a regular average day to keep their life with God fresh and alive. And so today we have a couple sharing, Helen and Craig's family.
Good Well, Pastor Rachel asked us to share on our spiritual practice. And the spiritual practice that we share most is prayer and meditation. Now, it's typically said that prayer is when you talk to God and meditation is when you listen to God. Helen is a much better listener than I am, so you can guess who does the meditation. I came to prayer almost 24 years ago when I got sober. My AA sponsor told me every morning to get on my knees and to pray and to ask God for help. And then every night to get on my knees right before I go to bed and thank him. Well, I really balked at that. He said, what's wrong, Craig? Something wrong with your knees? And I said, no. I just don't think God would want to listen to me. And he says, well, I really don't give a darn. Not his exact words, but I won't say what he told me. He said, you do it. If you want me to sponsor you, you do it. So I did. Every morning, asking him for help, and every night. Now, before I really believed that he was listening to me, what it did do is it framed the day. When I'm on my knees in the morning, the day starts, and right before I get to bed, go to bed, the day ends. Since then, I pray for many things. In the morning, particularly that his will, not mine, be done. I've learned just through experience that what God has in store for me invariably is better than what I might want. So I just ask that to get out of the way and let God do his thing. And then at night, I review my day. I give gratitude for what happened, and I also review my part in that day, particularly asking myself, have I been selfish? Have I been dishonest? Have I been afraid? Have I been resentful today? And if I have, I ask that God work on me to fix that. So those are two times a day that I pray, and the other time is that Helen and I, before we eat, we hold hands and we pray. And at that time, we get into, as Pastor Rachel says, an attitude of prayer. And we open up to God. God is always there. It's us that closes ourselves off from him. But we open ourselves to God, and at that time we pray for other people. We pray for whatever might be going on in the day. So in that spiritual practice, there's at least four times a day. Frequently you don't eat lunch, so it's breakfast and dinner. We pray four times a day. And that's basically my spiritual practice on prayer.
My meditation practice began about 20 years ago when a friend of mine asked me to attend a meditation group. And at first I said yes, and then I was a little hesitant because I was a little afraid, gee, gods and goddesses, Eastern religion. But I went anyway. And strangely, the person that was conducting, he was a yoga teacher at the YMCA, but he was also a Christian, and we meditated to Gregorian chant done by the Jesuit priests. So that sat well with me, and he recommended that I use a mantra. And again, I was a little hesitant, mantra. But he said, why don't you use what I use? It's Maranatha, and it's an Aramaic word that means come God, come Lord. And I said, okay, I can do that. So we entered his basement, and there were couches all around, and the room was dark, and there was one single candle in the middle. And it was the very first time, the room illuminated. I was peaceful and calm, and I felt the presence of God. So much so that I continued to practice for years. And it was really, really helpful when my mother was in a nursing home. And I would go to work all day. I would run to the nursing home at night. I'd come home around 9:30, sometimes 10 o'clock, and I would sit in my chair, and I would raise my hands and open my heart to God, and I would say my mantra. And it was as if all the stress of the day, the boss, my mom, the doctors and nurses, just evaporated from me. And I was able to sustain that for over a year that my mom was in the nursing home. And now my practice is a little different. I don't meditate every day. I meditate about four or five times a week. I don't have to say my mantra because I can get that still, silent mood of meditation quite easily now. But I open my hands and my heart to God and I say these words. I am one with God, I am one with the universe. I am a child of God, I am loved and I am blessed. And there have been moments where the room has brightened and I feel this connection that's so strong and so powerful that it brings tears to my eyes. And I feel so loved. And there are a few times when I hear that quiet, still voice that speaks to me and tells me that I'm loved. And that's my practice. Thank you so much. It's time for our offering. Let's pray. Lord God, you have given us so many gifts in so many different ways. Thank you for your word, for the insight of your Holy Spirit, for mission experiences, for daily spiritual practices. God, we ask that you would help us always to tap into that gratitude, that we would respond generously to you, that you would bless and multiply this offering to your work and ministry in the world. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
you for the announcement. A few announcements for you. First, I was going to have the other youth who are here, who attended the 30-hour famine, stand up and be recognized during Alex's time, but I forgot. So please stand on up if you went to the 30-hour famine. We're really proud of you. I know Aiden and Pete also. Aiden's back out with the kids with games. I think we have 13 from our church, which is wonderful. And thank you so much for sharing again. You'll notice in your bulletin a half sheet of paper. This is a lovely reminder that Easter is coming up in 2 weeks for you, but it's actually not meant for you at all. This is meant for your friend, your family, your neighbor, coworker, whoever it is that you would like to invite to Easter. Or stick it on your fridge if you're shy, and then when someone comes into your kitchen, you can say, oh, hey, look, right? Whatever you need. But this is for you to pass on, invitation to Easter worship, and then there's an Easter egg hunt. I think, I have no idea what we're going to do if there's snow on the ground. but we'll have some sort of Easter egg hunt, snow or no snow, for the whole community at 11:45 after the service. Please invite your friends. Our spiritual practices group that has been meeting after church during the weeks of Lent will not be happening today. This week's lesson is going to happen the first Sunday after Easter. It's not happening because we are having a surprise mystery meeting with lunch today that will start in about 20 minutes or 25 minutes or so after we have our coffee hour and visit and do the things we need to do. We're going to set up lunch in the back of this room, so whoever can help do that, a few tables up in the back of the room. And that meeting is going to last until about 1:30. It will not go past 1:30 for your scheduling. And you'll find out what it is when we get our lunch. So please feel welcome to stay for that surprise mystery meeting. Please remember the two-minute rule. If there's someone in this room whose name you forgot or who you haven't met yet, will you please go talk to that person during the first 2 minutes and then talk to your friend in a second? The only people I know who are running out the door immediately are the Lynches. So you can grab them first if you have to speak to them. And they're like, no, we have to go. Talk to someone you don't know first and then go talk to your friend. Valerie, did you want to announce about Sisterhood this week?
Yeah, anyone welcome?
Friday night, 7:30. Women only, is that right, for the sisterhood? We're drawing a hard line there, yes. All right, at Valerie's house. So if you need directions or any other information, please talk to Valerie after the service. For celebration and thanks, every week in this church, we celebrate and thank someone who has done great volunteer work for the church because the church runs on volunteers. I don't have anything on the sheet this week, so I will take one from the floor. Who are we celebrating and thanking today? Bobby?
All the Fisher kids for running around the sanctuary, making sure that the pews have the Bibles, the donation envelopes, the pencils, our hymnals, and all of that stuff every morning before we get in here.
All right, for the Fisher kids, for Steph and the Pew Heart. They're not in the room, so thank them in person. I think they'd appreciate it. All right. Please stand for the benediction. Oh, no, no. I'm so sorry. We have, this is the third Sunday of the month, so we have a kitchen update. George Schofield, come on down. You got a Crisis Right thing going on there, Daniel? No, Daniel. Daniel's getting my text from before church right now. Yes, please do tell us about the status of the kitchen.
Well, if you haven't stuck your head in there, I encourage you to do so. They've started putting the floor tile down. So that is a really big step. They've got about a third of the way done. It was scheduled to be done by today, but there was a fly in the ointment, I guess, and it didn't get quite that far. It's going to be grouted with a sanded grout that is a little grayer than cement. And the next step after that is to put the FRP on the walls. That's a fire retardant panel that has a bubbly, bumpy surface on it so we don't have to paint it or anything, be clean. And it's very maintenance free. The cafe doors are in the kitchen. First coat painted, they will go in, and then I think pretty much carpentry will be done, and we'll just be waiting appliances. So that's where we are.
Nice. George, do you have any speculation? Would you hedge any bets at all?
Don't do it.
Rachel, the last person I thought was going to throw me under the bus.
I know, I know.
I would guess if God is watching over us and
things, God is watching, so we can't say that.
Well, the best case scenario was 4 weeks.
Okay.
The worst case scenario was going to be later than that.
So maybe June is what you're saying. All right. Thank you, George. And George just serves. He's here, I think, every single day, checking up on the progress of that kitchen and managing. You can tell how much he loves it because he tells us about the grout. All right. Please stand for the benediction. May the God who has gifted us with life, with faith, with the hope and promise of new life in this world and in the next, God, the source of our generosity, be with us all until we meet again. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.